Will do. Good morning, everyone, and welcome to the Mayor's Environment Expo, a virtual session today. And we wanted to thank all of the sponsors and supporters of this Environment Expo, as you see here on your screen. We welcome you again this morning, and we're very excited to talk to you today about native trout. Before we get started on that, we'd like to broadcast a message from the mayor.
Welcome to the 33rd annual Mayor's Environment Expo. As we come together from around the city, I would like to acknowledge that the Calgary area where the Bow and Elbow Rivers meet is a place of confluence, where the sharing of ideas and opportunities naturally come together. Indigenous people were the original caretakers of this land and the first champions of environmental conservation. This land is a home that we all share, and it's vitally important that we protect our home, our environment, by working together. What drives my optimism is seeing the innovation and commitment to climate action from all of you, our students. I will continue to amplify youth voices on the climate crisis, and I look forward to hearing your ideas. I hope this session sparks conversations and encourages all of us to take greater action in protecting our environment. Thank you all for participating. Welcome to the third.
All right. I would like to echo the land acknowledgement that was stated at the beginning of the Environment Fair Expo, and also just describe the appreciation for the mayor's message at the beginning here. So welcome again. We're talking about this very, very beautiful fish, this Westslope cutthroat trout. And I want to give you a story about what's happening to this trout, and we're calling it against the current. And yes, this fish does swim upstream against the current, but it's also a metaphor for all of the challenges that this fish faces. So I'm coming to you today. My name is Charlene Fritz, and I'm from the Ghost Watershed Alliance Society. We are a watershed stewardship group and tasked by the Alberta government in 2002 under the Alberta Water for Life strategy. We are a local partner that works to protect the integrity of a specific watershed by doing on-the-ground actions. And so these are sort of the four pillars of what we do. We do education and outreach both beside the river and through the computer as today. We also conduct science and research and use that to provide advice and recommendations to decision makers. We also restore damaged areas. So we do habitat restoration projects in the Ghost Watershed as well. And I'd like to welcome my colleague, Marina Craner, the Executive Director for the Ghost Watershed Alliance Society. She will be moderating the three activities, student activities that we have planned for you today. So this is the overview. You can see the sticker, I love Alberta native trout. This is from the Alberta Native Trout Collaborative. And we'll talk more about who they are, but the four parts that we'll break down for you today, we'll just introduce what's going on with this fish, talk really specifically about its biology and its threats, and then the good news stories about what's happening to recover this fish. So here we're going to be listening to Westy, our Westslope cutthroat trout, give us a little bit of a description about his or her life cycle. And I hope to leave, dear student, I hope to leave this study with a better sense of how I live, how humans can harm or help me, and what you want for the aquatic ecosystems in your province. There is always more to learn, to question, and to discover, and you hold great potential in your hands. Sincerely, your friendly neighborhood Westslope cutthroat trout. So I just want to step back and say there is so much more to learn, and I'm going to just scratch the surface of some of the interesting parts of this trout's life. And there's more to learn. And it is your friendly neighborhood Westslope cutthroat trout, because these trout live very close to us. So who am I? Of course, I've said it several times, but the Westslope cutthroat trout is the common name, and you can see the red colored mark on the throat. There's a scientific name, and that's Oncorhynchus clarki lewisi, and it's crediting the explorers that first described this fish in the early 1800s. The most important thing here is that I am a native species of Alberta, and I have lived and adapted to conditions along the eastern slopes of the Rocky Mountains since the glaciers retreated over 10,000 years ago. This fish has been here a long time. So what is my quest? My quest is simply for survival. So I'm going to show you these two maps, and they're produced by the Alberta government, and it's showing a then and a now scenario. So on the left-hand map, you can see the green lines showing the distribution of these Westslope cutthroat trout before 1900. The right-hand map shows the distribution as of April 2013, so almost even 10 years ago. So you can see the really big contrast between a lot of Westslope cutthroat trout, and now there's not very many. And you want to note also that those green lines are along the BC-Alberta border in the headwaters regions of Alberta. So what happened? Why? We think about human population increase, about 70,000 people, growing to about 4.3 million people now living in Alberta. And what this has meant is decreased abundance. There's less individuals of this trout and decreased distribution. So these individuals exist in fewer places. So let's find out how and why this happened, and we'll also find out how humans are helping me. So why is it important that I survive? It's a really good question to ask, and we think about wildlife in all of its forms having value in and of itself. So just for the sake of the fish, it's important that it survives. And Canadians value all different types of wildlife for many, many reasons. It also has many meanings. So Westslope cutthroat trout are important to Indigenous people, both historically and currently. They're a symbol of Alberta's biodiversity. So the abundance and the range of life in our province, this is a symbol of it. And it's also something called an indicator species. So when we know that these native trout exist in our waterways, we know that that has it's a healthy aquatic ecosystem. They're also adapted to exist in extreme habitats such as colder and less productive ecosystems. Okay, let's get to the biology. So what do I look like? It's also called morphology. The simplest way to identify this fish is this red slash under the jaw. So that's very distinctive. Here is that opening photo that I showed you as well. And I want to just point out in the white and black diagram below, a few things that will become important when we're identifying fish. So there's a lateral line that extends horizontally, midline across the fish, and many, many different types of fins. The Westslope cutthroat trout has an adipose fin, making it a true trout. And these are the descriptors that we can use to identify these special trout. So they have a silver to yellowish green body, and their dark spots are more above the lateral line. So you can kind of see that midline, and that the darker spots are above that and more towards the tail. They have a reddish belly as an adult, and usually means they're spawning. And that, again, that red to orange colored slash in the skin folds of the lower jaw. Here's your first activity. So after that brief description of what the Westslope cutthroat trout looks like, can you pick out which one of these three fish is the Westslope cutthroat trout? Fish A, fish B, or fish C? So as you're thinking about this, Marina will be collecting your answers and just telling me what the response will be. And as you're considering these three fish, the other two that are shown here, we'll talk about them because they are actually important to the story of the Westslope cutthroat trout as well. Are we getting any answers yet, Marina?
Yes, we are getting a couple of C's and one B.
Okay.
Another B. And another C. And another C.
Great. And I would imagine that, you know, maybe not all of the classes are quite with us yet, but as you're joining, feel free to hop in and give your answer, fish A, B, or C for the Westslope cutthroat trout. Give you a few more seconds to think about that and enter your answer.
Okay, I got six, seven more C's coming in. Great. And one more B and another couple of C's.
Okay, well done. Thank you for everyone that participated and put their answer for us to see. It is fish C, that's the Westslope cutthroat trout. The distinctive feature here again is that red to orange slash underneath the bottom jaw. And you can see fish B, that was seemed like the second choice. It doesn't have that distinctive feature. So fish B is actually a brook trout. And a brook trout, its distinctive features are the white leading edges around the fins. It also has markings with halos. You can see sort of rings around its spots. And fish A is a rainbow trout, which often has a pinkish line along its lateral line. But well done if you picked C. Fish C is the Westslope cutthroat trout. Thank you, Marina, for telling me which ones were popped into the answers. So let's describe the difference and similarities. We did the rainbow trout, brook trout, and Westslope cutthroat trout, three really important fish to know and identify. So what is my life cycle, life history, and reproduction? So I'm going to spend some time on this diagram. This is showing how a trout will reproduce. And we're actually going to start with the breeding adult. So the female adult will sweep a little nest, a spawning nest called a red. And she does this with her tail and she sweeps the gravel. So she needs clean gravels to do this. She lays her eggs and then the male trout will fertilize those eggs. The eggs incubate in this nest for about 6 to 7 weeks. And then they emerge as alvin. So they're actually breeding right now in these headwater streams. They need between 6 to 10 degrees Celsius water temperature for them to start this spawning. Once the alvin emerge, they arrive with a little bit of food already at the bottom of, you can see that little sack, that yolk sack. It's almost like having a refrigerator attached to your throat. So the first few days, 7 to 10 days, they rely on the energy stored in that sack. And as they mature, they become fry. If they overwinter and survive those cold months, they become a juvenile. And then between 2 to 4 years, they mature enough to become a breeding adult. So during all the life cycle of this trout, they rely on clean water, clean and fairly undisturbed gravels. And they also need lots of dissolved oxygen for all of the parts of their life cycle. So what do I eat? What is the nutrition that this fish needs to survive? Well, we have quite an array here of bugs in this menu, but the three really important ones, which themselves are also indicators of good water quality. The top is a caddisfly nymph. The middle guy is a stonefly nymph. And the bottom is a mayfly nymph. And combined, these are three really important insects, aquatic invertebrates, that the fish relies on for its food. So if you're the kids menu, so the alvin again, we talked about that stored energy in the yolk sac. As they become fry, they eat small insects like chironomid larvae, which are also known as midges. And the older juveniles start to eat those bigger aquatic bugs, so aquatic invertebrates, which just mean they don't have backbones. So diptera, true flies, and ephemeroptera, which are the mayflies you can see there. As the adults grow, they need they can eat the same amount, same types of food as the juveniles, but they can also physically eat some of these larger macroinvertebrates like the trichoptera, the caddisflies, and the plecoptera, the stoneflies. Here's a stonefly nymph, and it's part of the Ghost Watershed. We've been monitoring these macroinvertebrates to test for water quality in a program called CABIN. the Canadian Aquatic Biomonitoring Network, and just these are very special bugs that also rely on clean, cold, and highly oxygenated water for their life cycle as well. So where do I live? What's my habitat? I currently am in headwater habitat, but in the previous map you saw, these fish did exist all the way through to Calgary and Lethbridge, but now they're confined to this headwater habitat. And headwaters are just the sources of the rivers, so they're typically the steeper slopes. There's lots of rapids and waterfalls and riffles. There are some pools as well. And we can think about the habitat for Westslope cutthroat trout as being the four C's. They need cold, clean, covered, and connected areas. And we'll just go through each one of those. So the clean in the upper left, you can see those gravels very clearly. They don't have a lot of sediment in it. And we'll talk about sediment in just a second. But they need that to sweep their spawning nests. And they also need high levels of dissolved oxygen, which pops us down to the bottom right hand for the cold. So if the temperature of the water is low, it will actually hold more dissolved oxygen. So they need these colder areas, cold water streams. Covered in the upper right hand, so you can see the willows and the pussy willows. This was taken in as spring, but you can imagine that each of those willows that are overhanging that stream provides all kinds of different benefits for the trout, including places and habitat for the bugs that they rely on for their food. We also talk about cover in terms of what's inside the stream. So things like woody debris, large boulders, they provide cover from predators and from the heat. So it gives some shade and protection that way. They also need in the lower left hand some connected areas. So they need different parts of the stream unfragmented, so they can complete all parts of their life cycle. They need different parts of the stream for feeding, for spawning, and the young also need more gentle areas when they're vulnerable as they're smaller. Okay, let's talk a little bit more about sediment. So we talk about sediment as foe for these native trout. So they need clean silt-free gravels, and the silt-laden gravels on the right are very difficult for the trout to complete their life cycle. Sediment is really just things like sand or silt. Particularly silt is a smaller particle, and it's the one that kind of clogs up these gravels. But sediment can be other things like organic bits of leaves and needles. So they have that as a foe, but they also have these riparian areas as friends. Now, what's under a riparian area? It's simply the place where land and water meet. It's this thin strip of soil and plants along the shorelines of streams, rivers, lakes, and wetlands that provide favorable conditions for biodiversity. There's a huge variety of life that exists in these riparian zones. So you can see the function of these riparian areas. We call them these cool corridors. They protect the stream banks from erosion. They filter out sediment and pollutants. They provide shade and cover to protect against heat and predators. And they support those plants that are habitat for invertebrates, which are the food source of those Westslope cutthroat trout. They also stabilize the banks and maintain channel shape, preventing warming and speeding currents. All of these are essential functions that provide excellent habitat for the Westslope cutthroat trout. So here's an example of a healthy riparian zone and an unhealthy riparian zone. You can see the willows overhanging in the healthy riparian zone. The channel is stabilized. There's lots of shade, protective cover. Now, unfortunately, in this unhealthy riparian zone, the soil has been compacted as people have crossed this creek with off-highway vehicles. And so the vegetation's been stripped, the soil has been compacted, and the riparian zone now is unhealthy. And you can see that it's quite a difference between the two. So let's put all this together. We'll talk about ecosystems and we'll fit the pieces and connect the dots. So what ecosystem am I a part of? I've sort of alluded to it already, but we're talking about aquatic ecosystems and of course, freshwater aquatic ecosystems. And I mentioned at the beginning, the Alberta Water for Life strategy. And one of the goals of that strategy was to protect and ensure that we have healthy aquatic ecosystems in the province of Alberta. Now, ecosystems are an interrelationship between living and non-living parts. And you can think about this a little bit like a soccer game. So are abiotic or are non-living factors or like the soccer field? So what does the field look like? So I'm going to read from this right-hand list. We're talking about things like elevation, the gravel and sediment in the channel, soil along the bank, water temperature, dissolved oxygen that I've talked about is so important, sunlight, wind and air, and the chemical and physical properties of water. So those are all the non-living factors in an ecosystem. That's our soccer field, so to speak. We also have our living factors, so things like bacteria, plankton, algae, invertebrates, aquatic plants and riparian plants, fish, we're talking about, of course, today, birds of prey and mustelids, but they all work together as the players in the soccer game, so to speak. So what is the game? The game is survival. And so when we think about these abiotic and biotic factors working and connecting together, there's many different interactions. And we'll just go through a few of these. So we know that two living factors can interact. So riparian plants provide cover and shade that protect the Westslope cutthroat trout. That's just one example. A second example is when living factors interact with non-living factors. So I've talked about the fact that Westslope cutthroat trout, those breeding adults need clean gravels for spawning. Riparian plants, so living factor, shade the water. That water is the abiotic or the non-living factor. Westslope cutthroat trout in all their life stages require dissolved oxygen and high levels of it. And they absorb this gas through their gills. And finally, we can look at interactions between two abiotic factors, so two non-living factors. And I've mentioned already that cold water holds more dissolved oxygen, and those higher gradient or steep slope terrain areas, such as the headwater areas of Alberta, those actually have higher water flow, faster water flow because of that steep slope. So those are some examples of how those interactions can work. And there's many more that I could mention. Just to look very briefly at some of the interesting parts of this ecosystem, we're going to look at a food web, and you've probably studied this already, looking at energy pathways. So the arrows in this diagram show how energy is moved from one area of a food web, so from one organism to another organism. So we know that the sun provides the energy input for all life. And so the producers, both the plants that produce in the water and the plants that are on the shore but fall into the water, those are relying on the sun's energy. They photosynthesize and then they become food or provide energy to the next level. So the primary consumers, like those scrapers and grazers you can see in the shredders, so those macroinvertebrates we talked about, rely on the producers in the water to get their energy. And in turn, those provide the energy to the secondary consumers, such as the stonefly nymph. Stonefly nymphs often are predators, not all of them, but they do eat other bugs. And then the Westslope cutthroat trout, or the trout, the fish in the water, they're the tertiary consumers. So they will eat all kinds of different bugs. And they rely, of course, on this entire food web to be intact. All right, we're getting to our second activity. So I'm going to set this up and get ready to enter your answers in the chat. We've got habitat hunt, and you have been hired to work as a fisheries biologist. And your first task, so if I was to hire you and ask you to create a habitat checklist. So what this means is we're going to look at different habitat features for aquatic ecosystems. And I'd like you to describe the word that best describes the habitat that the Westslope cutthroat trout is suited for. And that as bonus, we could think about the four C's of good habitat for Westslope cutthroat trout. So here is the first question. Well, this is what it looks like, and we'll give you the answer. I think you could probably guess as well. So the habitat feature, if we were looking at water quality in a certain stream, our field assessment would good, moderate, or poor, which one suits the Westslope cutthroat trout the best? And of course, it would be good water quality. And we can test water quality in different ways, but in general, we're talking about low sedimentation, high dissolved oxygen, and lack of pollution as well. Okay, so I'm gonna post this second question for this activity. And if you could think about each of these habitat features and how you would assess them in the field, identifying which is the best one for Westslope cutthroat trout. So the amount of sediments and gravels, dissolved oxygen levels, change in water levels, abundance of aquatic invertebrates, and amount of fragmentation. So of those five, I'll give you a minute or so to think about which ones, low, moderate, or high, best suits that habitat feature.
We have the first few answers coming in. Cold, okay. Clear, low. Amount of sediment in gravels, low.
Good.
Number two, high.
Great. Dissolved oxygen levels high. Great.
Yes. And answers are still trickling in.
Great. Now, as you're considering these questions, students, that third one I didn't talk about in ton of detail, but change in water levels, if you think about really high flows and then all of a sudden really low flows, what do you think that would be best for the Westslope cutthroat trout? Lots of changes, not very many changes. Think about the life cycle in relation to that question.
So we have one answer for all of the five habitat features, starting with medium, high, high, medium, medium. Then we have another answer, low sediment, also another low sediment, dissolved oxygen, high. Then we have low sediment, high dissolved oxygen, moderate change in water levels, high abundance of aquatic invertebrates, and amount of fragmentation moderate.
Okay.
Great. So we got more.
A little bit more time to answer.
Yeah. Dissolved oxygen has to be high. Number four, abundance of aquatic invertebrates moderate, change in water levels low. Change in water levels low. And we got one more. Dissolved oxygen high.
Great. Thank you so much for participating and putting in your answers. So if we look at those questions, absolutely, the amount of sediment in gravels should be low. That's ideal for the Westslope cutthroat trout. And again, lots of you put in high dissolved oxygen levels. That's excellent. The change in water levels relates to, for example, dammed or diverted water. And so when water levels drop all of a sudden, that's not really great for Westslope cutthroat trout. So we would want the water levels to remain fair, the changes to be fairly low. And then the abundance of aquatic invertebrates, we need lots of those. That's the food source of the Westslope cutthroat trout. And the amount of fragmentation, so remember we want those connected areas, so not cut up or sliced or fragmented. So we need a low amount of fragmentation for the best possible habitat for the Westslope cutthroat trout. Okay, the next one, deep pools or groundwater coming in. Overhanging riparian plants, boulders or large woody debris in stream, spawning areas, and again, aquatic invertebrates. I've snuck that in again. You can tell that that's an important one. So for each of those habitat features, could you tell me if the Westslope cutthroat trout prefers none, some, or many? So I'll give you a few minutes here to think about these five. And as you think about these, think about, again, the life cycle, think about the ecosystem, think about the friend and the foe of the Westslope cutthroat trout. And we'll go through these once we start to hear some answers coming in. So don't worry if you can't get it, just give it some thought and we'll go over these together. As you're thinking about this and Marina's collecting some of the answers, it'd be great if I was in person, I might ask you if you've ever seen a Westslope cutthroat trout before, if any of you go fishing. It'd be really neat to talk to you about some of your own personal experiences with native trout in Alberta and hear some of your stories. But and again, appreciate the teachers for coming to this session and really taking an interest in the native trout. They are such an important part of our natural heritage in Alberta. So Marina, are we getting some answers here or?
Yes, we are.
Okay.
So first answer we got was some deep pools. And then we have some, many, some and many.
Okay.
Then we have many. We have some, many, none, many, many. Many, some, many, many. And we got some, many, none, many, many. And another many, some, none, many, many.
Okay. Great. Thank you for participating in those questions. Let's go over what we know about Westslope cutthroat trout habitat and what they prefer. So these deep pools are the groundwater coming in. In order for them to overwinter, they need running water. So they can't have the ice going all the way down to the bed of the stream. And so they rely on those deep pools for the winter, or groundwater is warm and it will, if it comes into the stream, then it can keep the water running over the winter. So they actually need many of those different places so that they can survive the Alberta winter and those minus temperatures. They also need many overhanging riparian plants, and they need that for shade. They need it for the food source. They need it to stabilize and filter out pollutions along the bank. And then we talked about the cover inside of the stream. So boulders or large woody debris, things like logs that have fallen in, they need some of that for cover as well inside of the stream. They need as many spotting areas as possible. So lots of clean gravels they need. And again, they need lots of aquatic invertebrates for their food source. And well done if you had figured out or had been able to recite this, the four C's for their habitat: clean, cold, covered, and connected. Now, if you have any questions about this habitat, these questions, we can take some towards the end of the presentation. So if you could just save those, or if you type them in the chat, Marina could collect those and we can answer and address those towards the end of the presentation. So to sum it all up, they are an indicator species. These Westslope cutthroat trout, they reveal something about the ecosystem. If they are there, if they are present in our freshwater ecosystems, we know that there is good water quality, which means high levels of dissolved oxygen and low sediment loads. So our abiotic factors. We also know that the biotic factors are very healthy, that there's a functioning food web. And we talked about all the different ways that the life in the water is connected in that ecosystem. Okay, so what's the troubles? Now we understand the biology of the fish. What's been the threats? So what are the main threats to my survival? Natural threats like large flood events, predation, so meaning, different birds, for example, that will feed on the fish, on the Westslope cutthroat trout. But human threats are the biggest concern, and we can think about these in three broad categories, which we'll go over. One is hybridization, one is harvest, and one is habitat loss. So hybridization is when two different species mate and produce young that have traits from both parents, the young can reproduce. So, for example, Westslope cutthroat trout and rainbow trout are genetically similar enough that they can hybridize. So rainbow trout can hybridize with Westslope cutthroat trout. So what happens then is their young actually have traits of both of those fish. So over time, Westslope cutthroat trout that have been hybridized have less of those distinctive features. They're less fit for survival, and we say that they are less genetically pure. So the rainbow trout actually are not native to Alberta. They were brought from Eastern Canada and stocked or introduced into the Bow River. And that was around the 1920s. And the reason that they were stocked was for sport fishing. So a lot of tourists were coming to this area to do fishing. And at that time, there were no dams on the Bow River. And so these rainbow trout moved freely into other rivers and streams. But once those rainbow trout entered the aquatic ecosystems of Alberta, they changed those interactions in the ecosystem and they upset the balance. There's another invasive fish species that was also stocked in Alberta waters around 1903, again, for the sport fishing industry. And this was the brook trout. So this non-native fish species actually will outcompete the native Westslope cutthroat trout for food and habitat. They're a bit more aggressive feeder. And so like the introduction of non-native rainbow trout, the release of brook trout altered the existing aquatic ecosystem as well. So that was the hybridization threat. Now we're moving to the harvest threat. Now you can see in these photos, it's beautiful. People love to fish. They're called anglers, these people that love to fish. But unfortunately, too many anglers were taking too many Westslope cutthroat trout from their native habitat, and they were causing them to be extirpated, which just means locally extinct. So in some areas, these Westslope cutthroat trout disappeared altogether because they were overfished. So fishing rules changed to be catch and release, but it's also really important to understand that anglers also need to be careful on how they handle the fish when they release them so that they don't damage the fish and that the fish don't die as a result of that catch. The third main threat for the Westslope cutthroat trout is habitat loss. And I've talked to you about what they need in their habitat. And so some of the threats related to habitat loss are the damage done by various ways to riparian areas. So when vehicles cross through streams, they can damage both the riparian plants and the gravel bed that the fish need for spawning. And so repeated use of these areas compact the soil and increase runoff from erosion. And there's also improperly built or improperly sited roads and trails. So not properly considering the way sediment will flow off of those areas. And so the sediment ends up in the water, which we know is not great for the fish. There's other threats too. And we know that climate change will threaten the entire ecosystem and that the ecosystem will have to adapt. The fragmentation, we talked about that, making sure that if there's not enough connected habitat, then the fish won't be able to complete their life cycle. And disease as well, and whirling disease is something we could talk about if we have time towards the end. But it's all of these things are sort of stacked against the Westslope cutthroat trout. And putting this together, they're considered a species at risk. So both the Alberta and Canadian governments list these trout as threatened. And you can see in this diagram here on the left, there's a spectrum. So on the left is the green. They're not at risk, those species. And if we go towards the right in the spectrum, we can see on the red side, extinct. So this is categories of wildlife. And we can see in right in the middle is the threatened category. So this is where our Westslope cutthroat trout sits, both on the federal and the Canadian side as a threatened species. Okay, let's talk about recovery and what we can do to make sure that these native trout still survive. So first I wanna ask this question, why actually should we care? I've talked about the meanings and the reasons why wildlife is important all on its own. But this is a quote from Lauren Fitch. He was a fisheries biologist for the Alberta government. He started an organization called Cows and Fish, which takes a look at how land and water are connected and how we can protect our native trout. So I'll just read to you, and he poses a very important question. Why would we and why should we care about cutthroat trout? He says, cutthroat trout are a part, a feature of a watershed and an indicator of landscape health. Having cutthroat occupy these watersheds, and he calls this the gold seal of water quality. And then he says, the ripples that extend outward from a pebble dropped in a stream containing cutthroat inevitably find us. And it may well be that our own species will need these healthy watersheds with natural expressions of biodiversity and ecosystem services. It truly needs them now. So we'll talk about watershed when we talk about the ghost watershed. And ecosystem services are the benefits provided to humans by healthy, intact ecosystems. So watershed, you can think about as a funnel, for example. It's an area of land that collects and drains water to a common point. So the boundary or the rim of the funnel acts as the high points in a watershed. So in a natural setting, we can think about these as the ridges, the mountaintops, the upper parts of the hills. Those are the watershed boundaries. So when precipitation falls on the land, it collects and drains to a common point, either a river or a lake or ultimately to the ocean. You can see also that the water is stored in wetlands and also in the groundwater as well. So let's take a quick tour to the Ghost Watershed. You know, Calgary, Banff, you can see Banff in the mountains there. The Bow River connects Banff and Calgary, coming from Bow Lake, north of Lake Louise is the source of the Bow River from the Wapta Glacier. And the Ghost River Watershed is the area of land that collects and drains into the Ghost River. And the Ghost River enters the Bow River at the Ghost Reservoir. So there's a hydroelectric plant there. And this is the area where the Ghost River enters the Bow River. But all of the land in the Ghost River Watershed, the water comes off, and whatever's happening on the land has an impact on the water. So the Ghost River Watershed is part of the Bow River Source Watershed, which is the source of Calgary's safe drinking water. And you can see a rough sketch there. So the City of Calgary has been very proactive looking at making sure that the water that's coming into the Bears Paw Water Treatment Plant and the Glenmore Water Treatment Plant can be as healthy as possible. We all in Calgary, I live in Calgary, we rely on this water every day for showering, brushing our teeth, drinking water. And so when we take a look at protecting our upper watersheds, the City of Calgary has a source water protection plan, which is where this map comes from. So the Ghost River Watershed spans about 12% of the Bow River source watershed. The Westslope cutthroat trout lives in the freshwater ecosystems of our Ghost River Watershed. And just to give you a very quick tour of this, we have the North and South Ghost River coming in, meeting the Wapris Creek, and ultimately flowing into the Bow River at the outlet at the Ghost Dam. So you might note this red dot here at the confluence of the Wapris Creek and the Ghost River, and I want to take you there right now. So this is a springtime shot, and you can see the Wapris Creek on the left-hand side and the Ghost River on the right-hand side. And you can see this very dramatic visual line, and the Wapris Creek will often carry a lot of sediment, particularly after a rainfall event. And the reason is it's got more erodible materials along its banks and some steeper slopes, but it's also, related to the upstream human activity. So the water, reflects the land. So what's actually happening in the Ghost Watershed? Like the many places in the foothills, the Ghost River Watershed is a busy place, and human activities or land uses include recreation, including motorized and non-motorized and random camping, grazing, oil and gas extraction, and timber harvesting. And each one of these activities can have potential effects on the water quality. Best management practices mitigate and prevent a lot of degradation of the water quality. But we know that when we're on the land, we need to be aware that can impact the water quality. So the way that we can sometimes think about human land use or activities to think about our human footprint. And we can think about this as linear or spatial. So these lines, these trails, roads, seismic lines, anything that's a line on the landscape. And you can think about spatial footprint as well. So the bigger areas that you can see here. So is it one particular activity that's causing the Westslope cutthroat trout populations to decline? Well, no, it's all of those activities combined together. So it's called cumulative effects. And we can see in this map of the Ghost Watershed that's outlined in red, all of these orange lines represent a linear footprint. And every time one of those orange lines crosses a water course, so a small stream or a creek, or even the Ghost River, it has the potential to fragment or cause sedimentation. So this is our linear footprint, and you can see that there's quite a bit in the Ghost. If we think about the area that they used to live in the Ghost before 1900, we know now that they live in very few areas compared to pre-1900. So can we reverse the trend? Can we take where they live now and can we allow them through habitat restoration and other things to reach maybe or approximate some of the levels that they did pre-1900? Now, not all historic habitat is suitable today due to human or natural changes, but can we together reverse this trend? So let's get to the good news. What are people doing to help us, both groups and individuals? Governments, if we talk about that as the first layer, they need to know, decide, act, and repeat. So we do this through assessment, measurement, planning, research. So if we look at the Canadian government, they produce assessment and status reports on this fish, and they do this through research such as electrofishing, as you can see in the middle photo. So they have to identify where and how many of these fish there are. And then they produce recovery strategy and action plans for these threatened fish. For the Alberta government, they also produce the status of the Westslope cutthroat trout in Alberta. And the Alberta Native Trout Recovery Program is a recent initiative that brings together a variety of different people, stakeholders, and groups in a collaborative way, recognizing that it's the cumulative effects that are really threatening the Westslope cutthroat trout. It's happened over decades, so we need lots of people, and we're going to need a bit of time to make sure we can reverse this trend. So I'll just quickly talk about, again, those three problems: hybridization, harvest, and habitat loss, and some of the things we can do. I'm just going to skip over that so we can get to the next activity before you need to go at 10 o'clock here. So the harvest, we need to know the rules. You need to be able to identify the fish if you're an angler, and the government releases those regulations every year. For the habitat, there's things we can do if we're motorized recreationists. We can use designated trails that have bridges, so we're not crossing the creek. So we can use the bridges that have been supplied for us. Westslope cutthroat trout signage is in areas in the Ghost and the Wapris sub-basin. And some of this work has been supported by ourselves, the Ghost Watershed Alliance Society, and there's continuing work to be done. So here's some example of signs that we need to think about. Steer clear of ponds and creeks, and we now know the reason why we need to keep our wheels out of the water to make sure that these trout have habitat left. The other really interesting thing that is happening in the Ghost and other areas, headwater areas, is habitat restoration. And apologize for the fuzzy photos here, but essentially when we have damaged riparian areas, there's a variety of different things we can do to restore that habitat, including using native plant material like willows to reestablish those riparian areas. And the Ghost Watershed has done several projects in recent years to restore certain areas and protect fish habitat. Just an example of some of these willow plantings. Willows are incredible plants. If you plant them in a moist area, they will root out and leaf up and establish healthy plant communities along these important creeks. Okay, finally, we're getting to our final activity, predictive powers, activity three. And I think for the sake of time, we'll just go through one at a time. And if we run out close to 10 o'clock, then we'll just not be able to finish the last one. But let's see if we can try to get this done. Oh, Okay, so predictive powers. I'm going to give you some real life scenarios, and I'd like you to identify the threat or threats to Westslope cutthroat trout by placing a check mark in the box beside the ones that you think apply. So in the final line, if you could write whether you think the threat's been added or removed, and really it would probably be if the threat's been increased or decreased, but you can think about that. And so I'll just read this first real life scenario and you can get ready to type in whether you think the answer is A, B, C, D, or E. So let's just set this up for you. These are real life scenarios based on real things happening. So in Banff National Park, we have fisheries biologists that are looking to reestablish Westslope cutthroat trout. So they are successful in removing all non-native trout species from a mountain, lake, and stream. And they plan to reintroduce Westslope cutthroat trout here. And this actually is up towards Skokie in the Hidden Lake area, Corral Creek, if anyone is hiked up there. But could you tell me, again, so if we're trying to remove all native trout species so that we can reintroduce Westslope cutthroat trout, which threat are we addressing? Which threat are we trying to minimize or remove? Or are we adding one? So I'll give you a minute to think about that. You can type in A for hybridization, B for competition, C for flooding, D for harvest, or E for habitat loss. And again, Marina, if you start to see some answers come in, I'd love to hear what students are thinking.
Yeah, so far we got two answers.
Okay.
And they are A and B, and another A and B.
Great.
And we got another two answers, and both are A and B.
Excellent. So it sounds like the students that are participating really have understood hybridization, and competition absolutely is another threat that has been removed when non-native trout species have been taken from that mountain, lake, and stream. So just well done. So we've got hybridization, of course, as a threat for Westslope cutthroat trout. And so removing those non-native trout species removes that threat. And again, also competition. So if they're the only fish there, then they can, the food source for the macroinvertebrates is available to the Westslope cutthroat trout, and the competition is removed. Great. Let's do another real world scenario. So you have an unusual combination of a heavy spring rain and a deep winter snowpack. And this creates a large flood in the Ghost and in the City of Calgary, you might remember from 2013. Many aquatic invertebrates are washed away and their populations remain low in the summer, and sediment washed into spawning gravels. So this might be a fairly obvious threat. This is a natural threat. So you could just type in if you think A, B, C, D, or E is the threat here, and whether it's being added or removed. So just as you're thinking about that and you're typing it in, and Marina will let me know, but this photo here was taken in the Ghost, and this raging river going from bank to bank. It's just remarkable to see the volume of water that came through at that time. And it definitely altered not just the habitat for the trout, but also the shape of the channel.
Okay, so I got one response so far. It is C, added.
Great.
And then there's another four times C.
Great. So that was a pretty easy one. So this is a natural threat, the flooding, and it has been added. All right, let's go to our third scenario. So Westslope cutthroat trout spawn along a certain reach of stream, and for years, a riparian area just upstream of this important habitat had been damaged by motorized vehicles crossing through the water. The government installed a bridge, and a local watershed stewardship group worked with a group of motorized recreationalists to plant willows and repair the shoreline. So which threat has been either added or removed? Hybridization, competition, flooding, harvest, or habitat loss? So A, B, C, D, or E?
So we got the first answer is E, removed.
Great, so habitat loss removed, good. Thank you, students, for participating. If you could keep typing in your answers, that would be great. We could start to see what you're thinking about this real world scenario.
We got another 2E removed.
Okay.
And we got D and E with a question mark.
Okay.
Stopped habitat loss.
Okay.
E removed. Another 2 times E removed.
Okay, great. So we are removing habitat loss when we install these bridges and repair the riparian areas. It's interesting the answer that came through about harvest. So the harvesting of the angling of the fish probably won't be reduced by installing a bridge. It would rely on the anglers knowing how to identify the fish and how to properly handle them. But definitely the habitat loss will be decreased once those motorized recreationists can use a bridge to cross those streams and creeks. So we're running out of time here. I just want to wrap up the predictive powers. Again, when we talk about angling, the harvest, barbed and barbless hooks make a difference. So that's related to the fishing regulations. And so if we remove that harvest threat, then we're going to increase the chances for the Westslope cutthroat trout to survive. The last one is talking about forestry companies installing sediment fences and keeping a buffer of trees and shrubs beside the creek. That reduces the threat of habitat loss by preventing sedimentation in these creeks. So I just want to say thank you for coming to this presentation. We want to just also mention that there is the Alberta Native Trout Collaborative, and there's a website with lots of great videos and more sort of colorful images related to Alberta's native trout. And I can give you that website. It's also in the teacher package that was sent around. So we want to make sure that we understand this is a group effort, and lots of different groups will be required to protect these Westslope cutthroat trout. And I'll just finish this off by saying some of the last remaining populations of pure Westslope cutthroat trout exist in the Ghost River watershed, and it's a native species of Alberta. And these once widely distributed fish had healthy populations throughout the eastern slopes. Today, their range and numbers have dwindled, giving them the unwelcome title of species at risk. If nothing is done to reverse the trends, these fish will become only a recorded memory of our once rich biodiversity. And how will the story end for these Westslope cutthroat trout? It really is in our hands. And as students, there's ways that you can become involved too. But we want to just think about this as a collective effort, lots of different groups working together to protect these very special fish. I want to thank the support from the following organizations for allowing us to do our own work, and got references there. This slide deck that I just did is also available on our website. So I'll leave it probably here. And if you had any questions or comments as we wrap up this session, please type them in. I'd be happy to hear from you, whether it's a comment related to the presentation itself or a question about these fish. Thank you for your attention. We went through quite a bit of material this morning together. So Marina, if you see anything popping up, you could maybe just read that
It's Charlene, it's Lindsay, the producer for your event from the city. Right. I'm just going to hit the end button, but I've let our participants know that we'll keep the chat open for the next 10 minutes. So if they post their questions in the chat, we'll still answer through the Q&A, but we're going to end the live broadcast now to stay on time.
Okay, thank you, Lindsay.
Yeah, thank you. It was a beautiful presentation. Thank you so much.
Oh, you're welcome.